The Race and Cultural Relations Leadership Network is a standing committee of the Greater Indianapolis Progress Committee. It was established to serve as a mechanism to foster positive relationships among diverse populations and to respond to racially and culturally charged issues in the Greater Indianapolis community. The RCRLN has operated mainly behind the scenes to address issues such as police community relations, business and economic development, immigration, and education for more than 25 years. 2020 was an extraordinary year. What follows tells the story of our work this year. The pandemic. In March of 2020, seemingly out of nowhere, COVID-19 roars into our consciousness and everything changes. The worst global pandemic of our lifetime demands a shift in everything we do. And the RCRLN pivots to twice monthly virtual meetings.
It's about three times as contagious as influenza. And so we feel we're going to see definitely way more hospitalizations and way more deaths compared to any other virus we've seen in the history of this country, except for maybe the 1918 pandemic flu, a respiratory condition that progresses into pneumonia. And they develop a lot of them something called acute respiratory distress syndrome, where over time you develop a scarring of the lungs, and the lungs are so scarred, it's like a sponge. It becomes solid and you can't even expand your lungs in order to breathe, and that's why you require a ventilator.
The immigrant and refugee community, I think one of the biggest challenges is that there hasn't been a ton of information in native languages distributed early enough. And I think that has something to do with why potentially people aren't taking some of the health measures as seriously as the English-speaking population. Just having access to resources. Folks need more support resources now than ever. And if you have to provide an ID to access those, if you have to be of certain status to be able to access those, if any of the information about those resources aren't in a language that you understand, it's going to be really hard for folks to be able to get the resources they need.
In May, police involved deaths of Drayshon Reed locally and George Floyd nationally spur a racial reckoning and demand for police reforms. Indianapolis, like most cities around the country, sees massive protests, some of which turn violent. Tension is high and conversations begin about whether America is finally going to address systemic racism.
The Reed incident, again, was also exacerbated by, and I don't want to get into the specifics of the shooting itself, but it's clear, I think we all agree, this is a young man, and I've met with the mother and father, and the mother has even made the statement. This is a young man, clearly, immature. That's clear to see on the video, dealing with some mental issues, all of that. That's not in dispute. What we all witnessed was something that was posted on live Facebook, which also exacerbated the situation. What we argue in the community is what appears to be excessive number of gunshots and injury. And then finally, what put it over the top were the comments from the police officer.
Take a moment to provide a brief update on the recent officer-involved shooting related to Drayshon Reed on May 6th. I would like to address the comment made by one of our officers at the scene that was picked up during the live Facebook stream. The comment that was made was in poor taste, and it was insensitive to the serious situation that was at hand. As a department, we take to heart the call to a higher standard. Every day our officers work tirelessly to do their best for our city. I'm proud of the contributions they make, and I'm committed to addressing the situations where behavior does not reflect the values we strive for within our agency.
The trust between the community and law enforcement has been truly broken all the way. And so when I say that, as speaking from as a community leader, we have been in meetings and meetings and meetings over the years, sitting down with different stakeholders, different law enforcement, different elected officials. And they always ask us what can we do to build the relationships between them and the community? But how can, as a community leader, continue to hold our community accountable when the police department won't hold their police officers accountable? And so that destroys the trust.
The community's frustrated and angry because they feel like they're not being heard. This has been happening, once again, from a historical standpoint, going all the way back through the history of our country. And now it is time to stand up. We have to look past just basic reform with IMPD and look at state reform, because the legislation is the one to make a lot of the overhauls of what goes on in our society and our community. And I think that's something that we need to continue to look forward to. But at the same time, we need to continue to spread awareness of how do we engage with the community, what's going on in our community, how we feel.
The grand jury indicted two IMPD officers earlier, about 2 weeks ago, in relationship to an incident that occurred during the protests. And so that case is now beginning to work its way through the process. I think there was a lot of conversation about what was the best way to handle that case.
Disparities exposed. Summer drags on, and the disproportionate impact of COVID-19 becomes clearer, with minority communities experiencing higher exposure rates and worse health outcomes. Though the pandemic is not the beginning of inequity, it exacerbates challenges in housing and homelessness, food access, health care, and education. Indy's most vulnerable populations are further at risk.
Our highest vulnerable populations in our communities are our homeless population, of which a significant percentage of them disproportionately are African Americans, with Latinos part of that homeless population.
For the first time ever, you know, we're all being faced with challenges that none of us chose, you know, to have to be faced with. But we all have very different resources to address those. And, you know, the first ones that were hit, and it really hit home with me, because out my window here in the office, I see right out onto Market Street. And a lot of our homeless congregate right out there. And you say, self-quarantine yourself in your home. Okay. If you've been downtown lately, the city of Indianapolis in the core downtown area, now that people aren't coming in every day, that's their home. And the streets down here, if you've been self-quarantining, thank you, first of all, and if you haven't been out. But I'm just telling you, from driving in here to 50 North Alabama, our downtown looks very different. We have people that have come out into the core business areas wandering the streets. They have no place to go, our homeless population. Our units that address making sure that they're fed, making sure that they're screened for symptoms, then finding places for them to quarantine if they do have symptoms. They have been really, really busy throughout this and from the very get-go.
Bill of Rights that took effect July 1st, that we've been in the process of notifying landlords of that ordinance's existence. And all it does is inform tenants of their rights under city ordinance to live in decent housing that isn't in violation of health codes or city ordinances. And kudos to Dee's work raising awareness of this ordinance's existence and tenants' rights. That's at the very least that we can do during normal times to try to reduce that 9,000 to 12,000 number of evictions. That confirmed what we all sort of suspected, is that this is an acute problem that is not going away anytime soon. And it's not something that we can solve by ourselves at the city level. Like, we need access to much, much larger and longer term sources of funds.
Developing a relationship with an advisor is important. It doesn't matter how much money you have. There's a stigma. There are some really bad feelings of inadequacy and personal worth when we're not able to provide housing for ourselves or our families. This is something that has become more of a common thread amongst all of us who live in an environment where housing is for you, for me, when it could be taken away from us in a minute.
In the midst of everything going on, it's still tenants living in mold, in habitable living conditions, and living in feces, living with ceilings caved in, open. When it rains, it just comes down the side of the wall. When they had three or four children, I'm dealing with a family right now who apartment has been flooded. IHA property, it has been flooded for 2 weeks. 2 weeks. And they still to this day have not gotten the assistance they need.
So we basically became a logistics company overnight. We took some of our technology out of our elementary schools, to two of our high school campuses, prepped them, shipped them via UPS to high schoolers' homes because they needed to be able to stay on track toward graduation. And it was really important that they were in those credit-bearing classes. We also purchased in April about 1,500 hotspots because, again, we knew I can give you a computer. If you don't have high-quality internet access, that computer is not going to do anything for you. And so we also had to distribute those hotspots to families who needed them. So it fundamentally changed the way that we do education. The questions we're thinking about now are, we know at some point in the year, we will likely be in that virtual environment, even for students who are going to choose to come back in person. We also are offering a fully virtual environment for families who are not ready to come back into the physical school facility. And so how do you build strong, authentic relationships?
I think one of the biggest challenges is teachers having the materials in both English as well as other languages. In addition to not only thinking about the language barriers for the students, but also the parents. Kind of as Rebecca mentioned with the deaf and hard of hearing community, if anybody has kids, you know that you're also a teacher now and having to go through these materials with your kiddos. But if that information isn't necessarily accessible in different languages, then it's hard sometimes for the students to fully comprehend, in addition to the parents, if the teachers aren't able to take the time to have sessions with students with an interpreter to make sure that they're answering questions.
What this school district plans to do to meet the needs of those families and those students who have, for lack of a better word, kind of taken a sideline to those that are privileged in the school district. We intend to look at that and do something about it. And we have been hearing both from parents and from staff members that are very anxious to get back into our motivating training that we have been doing, so that we can address the inequities that have been there for a very, very long time.
Of course, we have our most vulnerable population of our children who are children of color. And we additionally have our children, many times children who are of color, who have significant special needs. So one of the things that we are working with the schools and working with families all has to do with how special education is being implemented during this period of time.
Youth voices weigh in. In this time of pain, uncertainty, and fear, we need to hear all voices, especially those who experienced the longest lasting effects of 2020. a panel of indie youth share what it's like to be young and Black in our city and challenge us to embrace uncomfortable conversations and learning opportunities.
This concept of this current time that we're in of these conversations where if you say Black Lives Matter, you're going to have people who were torn back with All Lives Matter. For the young people on the panel, can you explain how you feel about race relations currently? And let's just go with our city. Let's just go with Indianapolis, because there's enough here to talk about.
One thing is that with the African-American community, there's no trust with the IMPD right now. So it's hard when you're trying to go out and live your life and you know that, you know, your counterparts or other people that you're out here with, whether they're white or whatever race, that, you know, they have a system that supports them. But the way that I look at it is like a relay race. So if you think about it, if we've been stopped at the start, you can't just say go and expect us to win the race or even catch up, because it's been generations upon generations of us being stopped or being held down and oppressed.
And when talking about race relations, what a lot of Black people will say is that the Latino people are the closest thing we have to understanding what we're going through in America. And the crazy part about that is like over the past few months, what you've seen is a lot of Latino communities coming out saying, oh, we don't mess with Black people. There has to be some sort of power balance to this thing. White people are able to oppress us due to their power. The Latino people, in my personal opinion, cannot be racist towards us due to the fact that they do not have that power.
Settling into the new normal, we are mindful of the mental health impacts of this moment in history, the stress of facing a global pandemic, racial reckoning, and vitriolic elections simultaneously. We know that for a variety of reasons, communities of color and the most vulnerable among us suffer more in times like these. And we explore ways to deal with that stress.
During this pandemic, and one of the surprising findings was that people were concerned about not having access specifically to their mental health medication. So as a result, from those findings, the churches have been involved and they're really working with the community to determine, to make sure that nobody falls in the gaps in terms of having access to the prescriptions and ensuring that they are able to maintain their maintenance drugs in terms of mental health. Postpartum depression is a huge issue separate from the coronavirus, but we're working to mobilize around the state. We did our first virtual town hall yesterday, and we're going to be doing that more to look at those special issues, and mental health is certainly one of them.
But one of the biggest issues is mental health and trauma. Especially with COVID-19 happening, just randomly happening to us, it has took our mental health and trauma out the roof. And so with the police brutality, it just added more complex trauma to us, because we are already in deep, deep trauma. And so no one's talking about mental health and trauma and just in communities, in vulnerable communities. I mean, that's why you see a lot of people act out in anger, are tired, ready to just give up, ready to throw in the towel, because it's like they've been hit and hit and hit over and over again, and they're tired of getting back up.
The network has really helped guide us through this process over the past 25 years. And with overwhelming challenges that our communities face, there's a need today like never, ever before. I'll say this personally, and I do believe that it is time for more community input and decision-making processes to help establish some level of trust in those processes and validate the concerns of community members. I think too often we give too much authority to others and have no voice in that. And I think we need to make a determination to focus on the voices of our community members, especially those who are the most impacted.
Moving forward together. In 2020, challenges abound, but the RCRLN remains the go-to forum to tackle hard problems, listen to many voices, and work to make. make progress. To learn more about the work of the RCRLN, please visit our website at www.ndgipc.org/initiatives/RCRLN.